everybody. Welcome back to Saturday Night at the Well. It's so good to see you. So good to be with you. Are you enjoying your snack together? Good. Excellent. Yeah, snuggle in. Get comfortable. Missed you. Okay, let's get to it. We're going through a series currently with our students. It's called Icebergs, and it's centered around the fact that with icebergs, what we really see is only like the top 10%. The rest of it is below the water, right? The other 90%, that's math. 90 plus 10 is 100, 100%. Icebergs are fascinating to me. If you've been here long enough, you might have noticed that I'm a little bit of a nerd. I love nerds. There's nothing wrong with them. I think they're beautiful, because I am one. But I just want to give you a couple quick, like, statistics, little known facts about icebergs, because I promise it's relevant, sort of. Okay, did you know that one of the biggest icebergs in the world towers 551 feet in the air, which is like the same as a 55-story building? I'm only 5'4", so that's pretty tall. That's like more than 10 of me. No, wait, do math. 100 of me? Yeah, math, 100 of me. Yeah, so 90% of an actual iceberg is underwater. We don't get to see that part. Icebergs can weigh as much as 100,000 to 200,000 tons. So if a ton is 2,000, and the iceberg weighs 200,000 of those. They weigh a lot. They're very heavy. I don't know how they float. Science? Salt water? Smaller icebergs are called bergy bits or growlers, and I think that's the cutest thing I've ever heard in my life. And icebergs make a fizzing sound as their ice melts underwater because ice air bubbles are like being released. You're welcome. Aren't you glad you came to learn something new? Why are we talking about icebergs? Because for the next few weeks, I want icebergs to be kind of the representative of our lives in this series that we're going to talk about. So many of us focus so much of our time and our attention and our energy on that top 10% that everyone can see, right? We do our hair nice. We wear makeup, if you wear makeup. We want to make sure that our fit is good. We want to wear clothes that people like, that look nice on you, that look good. We worry about all these things and how we come across to other people, when in reality, we should be focusing on the 90% that people cannot see. And that is my challenge to you through the next couple weeks. How can you switch that mentality around so that you are focusing less on that 10% and more on that 90% that people see or people don't see that's under the surface? So that's just keep that in mind for the next couple weeks. That's our lens. It's our reference here. I don't know anything about sports, basically. What I do know about sports, hashtag elder millennial, is from when I was a kid, and the greatest basketball player at the time and of all time was Michael Jordan, and he played for the Chicago Bulls, and that was like the last time I knew anything about sports. There could be some heated discussion. There won't be, because I'm right, about who is the best basketball player of all time. And I'll just say Michael Jordan. And you can leave a comment telling me if you think I'm wrong, and I'll probably delete it. No, I won't. But Michael Jordan played 15 seasons in the NBA. He won 6 NBA championships. He averaged over 30 points per game. I can make about 4 if someone's not paying attention. He was in the NBA final. He was the NBA Finals MVP 6 times. He was Rookie of the Year. He's been inducted into the Hall of Fame. He has 2 Olympic gold medals. How many people know that? And he set several records and won many more awards over his career. He once said that you can practice shooting 8 hours a day, but if your technique is wrong, then all you're going to get good at is shooting the wrong way. So you get the fundamentals down, and the level of everything, then the level of everything you do will rise. And that's what I want to focus on today. Michael Jordan was known not just for being a great basketball player, but because of the level of determination he had and the level of practice he committed to, accomplished. He practiced a lot. That's how he got good. I think sometimes, especially when we're starting something new, we think, oh, I'll practice a lot once I get the hang of it, because we don't like the uncomfortable feeling of repetitively doing something we're bad at. But you get good at doing something because you practice. And that's what Michael Jordan did. He practiced and practiced and practiced and practiced, and then eventually became the best player of all time. All time. Why am I telling you about icebergs and Michael Jordan? Well, other than the fact that it's incredibly fascinating, you're very welcome. I think they also tie into an incredible story in the Bible that I will confess I did not like when I was younger. We're going to talk about the life of David over the next couple of weeks. And most people know him as King David. Wasn't always a king. Didn't start out that way. Wasn't born into a royal family. But yeah, I confess I did not like David for quite a while when I was younger, because of, I think, one of the biggest parts of his story. And David is known in the Bible as a man after God's own heart. And I was like, wow, that's a very generous title for someone who makes some pretty sketchy life choices. And so it took me a while to agree with that statement, that title that David holds. And so I just want to, I guess, share all these good things with you so that you can come to know David as the complex and interesting character that I know today. So if you want to read about David, his story basically starts in the book of 1 Samuel. So I encourage you to read through it. It's long, but it's incredibly fascinating. It has a lot of twists and turns. But the verse that I want to focus on today in the next couple of weeks is 1 Samuel 16, verse 7, which says, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, 10%, but the Lord looks on the heart, 90%. Isn't that true? So true. We are incredibly judgmental little creatures, and we have to practice that out of ourselves. But so when we come upon David's story, when we come about in the beginning of it, there's a man named Saul who is the king. And he basically became king because Israel, God bless them, complained and complained because they wanted a king. And God said, okay, have a king. And they chose Saul because Saul was tall and strong and good looking, and he seemed like a king, right? Well, Saul made some life choices that were a little questionable too. And some of the things he did were very offensive to the Lord. And so God was like, it's time to find this guy's replacement. He's not cutting it. That's not it. So he sends a prophet, Samuel, to the house of Jesse. And he says, from Jesse's sons, pick a new king. So Jesse trots out all his sons. They line up, you know, oldest to youngest. And he looks at all of them. And God says, this is Samuel. Don't look at the outward appearance. Don't look at how tall or how handsome or how strong they are. I've rejected them all. And so he looks at all the sons and he's like, oh my God, God's rejected all of these ones. Do you have any other sons? And basically says, well, yeah, I've got one more. But that's just little David. He's out in the fields shepherding. He's not a king. Oh, we'll bring him out anyway. And as soon as David comes up, Samuel says, oh, that's the one. So he anoints him as king. The interesting part, though, is that, I mean, Samuel's probably, I'm going to get all the names mixed up, the whole story, you guys. David is probably a kid, probably like a young adult, like maybe, let's say 15-ish, somewhere in that range. And he is anointed as king, but he doesn't take the throne yet, okay? And if we look at the life of David, specifically like his shepherding business, he spends a lot of time by himself and spends a lot of time with God. And I think that's going to be so key in this story, because in that time, especially that time with God, he is working on his heart and his character and developing all of those things and turning into the person, the man that God wants him to be. He's doing all of this unseen work, this 90% below the surface, and it is changing who he is. Okay? So one day, his brothers, it's like story time, I love this. His brothers have gone out with the army to fight the Philistines, neighboring country who, if you watch VeggieTales, just made a lot of peas. But the Philistines decide they don't want to fight. They're going to make it easy. So they send out their champion, their one warrior, and they say, bring out your champion, and whoever is the winner, the other team, the losers, will be the other person's slaves. I said that so wrong, but hopefully you get it. And so Israel agrees, like, okay, cool, we'll do this. But when the Philistines send out their champion, he's massive. He's like over 9.5 feet tall, and he's this huge, burly dude named Goliath. And nobody in the Israelite army volunteers to fight him. This goes on for several days. And so finally, David gets sent to like take his brother's food, provisions or something. And and he's kind of like, what's everyone doing? Why isn't anybody fighting this big dude, Goliath? Like, why is nobody volunteering? And basically, David volunteers to do it. This kid, this teenager, he volunteers to do what all these men would not, because David knew that Goliath wasn't just his enemy. He was God's enemy. And the trust that he had in God to work on his behalf gave him the confidence that he needed to step up to a task that everyone else said was impossible. And that was the state of David's heart. You see? And all that work that he had been doing, all of that character development, all that heart work that he'd been doing with the Lord in that quiet time, in that that secret place, you know, is what enabled him to do this great big thing. It was the practicing before he could do this great big thing, just like Michael Jordan. So David, that's the first step in David's journey toward being recognized as this great man of God. The fact that in those private moments, he put in the work and did the practice so that when he needed it, he was able to do it. Does that make sense to you guys? We've talked a while back about spiritual practices. Our friend Grace taught us about it and it was awesome. And there's lots of different ways to do spiritual practices, but one of her points was that we don't have to do things perfectly for them to be looked on favorably by God, because they are practices, and practices, when you practice, you make mistakes. We're teaching my daughter to ride her bike right now, and she's a little bit of a perfectionist like me, and she hates it when she falls or when her feet get a little caught up in the pedals, because she wants to do it perfectly right now. And it's been so hard to teach her that when you're practicing, you're gonna make mistakes. That's just a fact of life. And you have to anticipate those mistakes, and you have to keep practicing, because the more you do it, the better you will get. Will you ever be perfect at it? No, because perfect doesn't exist. But when we practice and we aim for perfection, we usually get greatness. And so practicing in our spiritual lives, what would it look like to practice your faith? What would it look like to practice your faith? David was a man who was practicing his physical job for years, right? He was growing strong. He was fighting off bears and lions to defend his sheep. Like, of course he's going to take down this giant dude. But he was also building his relationship with God the whole time. We don't know much about that part of his life, because those were in his private life. Those are the private moments that were not written down in scripture for us to look at. But that's no different from our need to build our relationship with God in our private lives. And the goal is not to be like publicly awesome at your faith. That's not why we practice. But sometimes God will call you to do something big, possibly in a public setting, And then we have a choice to make. Are we going to prepare ourselves like David, or are we going to be like Saul, who gets really bent out of shape when someone does something better than him? So David was fearless in this moment because he knew that God was with him. And I think if we remembered that and we spent the time with him, having that reaffirmed in our minds and in our hearts, we could do so much more than we think we're capable of. I absolutely believe that. And David was confident that the Lord would move in big ways in the future because he had moved in big ways in the past. So there's something to be said for David's practice, but also for consistency. The more time he spent with God, the more he learned about God's character, the more he could trust who God was and what he was going to do. So I just want to encourage you guys that when it comes to our spiritual lives, our relationship with God, our faith, spiritual success, first of all, good thing for you to define that for yourself. What is spiritual success? But spiritual success starts with a heart that is devoted to Jesus, a heart that is willing to put in the time and the effort to work on the 90% that people don't get to see, the stuff that's below the surface. It is so important to develop our hearts and our character with God because, you know, the Bible says that everything flows from our hearts. Our beliefs decide our actions and our words. So if you think about the kind of person you want to be, the kind of faith you want to have, you actually get a say in that. Life doesn't just happen to you as much as we like to think sometimes. So what is the main point? What I want you to work on this week? What I want you to consider? I want you to consider, what would it look like to practice your faith in the quiet times? What would it look like to be like David, who was developing his heart and his character and his relationship with God? What would it look like for you to do that? And how do you define spiritual success? I bet we would all have very different answers to that question. So David is a great person. David is a great person to like model your life after, or like have as a spiritual hero. I admit it. We're going to learn some more about his story next week. What do I want? Yeah, no, that's it. We're going to learn more about David next week. So this week, how do you find spiritual success? And what would it look like for you to practice your faith in your life? Okay? And we practice things before we need to do them. Just think about that statement. Anyway, I would love to pray for you. If you guys ever have something specific you would like us to pray for, we'd love to know about it. So you guys can send us a message. You can drop a comment, whatever you want to do. We'd love to pray for you. So let me do that right now. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the example that David was. We tend to be so callous in our judgment of characters in the Bible and just pick apart their lives, point out all the mistakes. But what a daunting thing to be used as an example for generations and generations and thousands of years. I know I would not want my life to be put down in words for all to see and to look at for millennia to come. But we do thank you for the people that you chose to teach us the things you need us to hear. We thank you for the way that you worked in David's life. And because you did that for David, we know you can do that for us. So I pray, God, that we would have the courage to meet you this week and invite you in to these parts of our lives. Invite you to take control and to develop the 90% of us that's below the surface that people don't get to see necessarily, God. Help us in those private moments in our lives, in those quiet times, to focus on you and to worry less about all the outer stuff that people can see. It's good to have cool shoes or nice hair, Lord, but that is not what makes a good life. So I pray, Lord, that you would meet us where we are this week and that we would be courageous enough to let you in and to begin to partner with you to develop our hearts, to develop our character, and most importantly, Lord, to develop our relationship with you. I think we take you for granted too much of the time, Lord. How precious and miraculous it is to know that I have access to my Creator at all times. That is the most important relationship in my life, God, and I pray that you would convict all of us, that we would return to that, and we would have a deep desire to be in a relationship with you. So God, we thank you. We thank you for your love. We thank you that you love us every day, no matter what. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, King David, icebergs, Michael Jordan. Three things you didn't know together. You didn't know they go together, but they do. Guys, you've stuck with me through this whole message, and I have fumbled over my words more than I think I have in several weeks. I don't know what's wrong with my brain. But anyway, I hope you have an awesome rest of your weekend. If you want something funny to do or to entertain yourself, go ahead and look us up on TikTok, thewell.youthman, and help us come up with some interesting ideas for content, for videos. I'm having fun learning about it. I feel like maybe I'm too old to be there, but I still enjoy it, so whatevs. But yeah, TikTok, good stuff. I'll see you next week here at The Well. Okay? Bye.